On the 17th of December 1942, Raus's 6th Panzer Division attempted to retake Verkhny-Kumsky. They did expand their bridgehead slightly, but were stopped by heavy fire coming from several Soviet units, with a loss of 14 of roughly 70 panzers. Just to note, Raus's account of the action here is fairly inaccurate, as indicated by other sources, so it's not worth using him at this point. To the west, the 17th Panzer Division had arrived, and with just 30 or maybe 50 panzers, just a third of the trucks it should have had, only 2,300 men, and missing all its armoured cars, this division was incredibly weak. Nonetheless, it was sufficient for its immediate task of throwing the 81st Cavalry Division and nearby units back across the Aksai River, which is what it did that evening. At this point, the Soviets in the area had 60 or 77 tanks, while Kirchner's corps fielded between 125 and 165 panzers, so the advantage had shifted back to the Germans. But only on the ground. In the air, the Soviets had shifted their forces around, meaning that the 8th Air Army was now able to fully support 51st Army. Hundreds of sorties were launched per day starting on the 17th, and these helped reduce the pace of the German advance. One thing to note is that the sources contradict each other with regards to whether the Germans received any Tiger tanks or not. Supposedly, the 65th Panzer Abteilung reinforced 6th Panzer Division around about this time, and that this battalion had a few Tiger tanks in it. But it's not clear which day this battalion appeared, and other sources can't seem to agree on whether Tigers did or didn't participate in Operation Winter Thunderstorm. Also, this battalion may have already been a part of 6th Panzer Division, having been absorbed in July. So I'm not sure what's going on here, but if Tigers were in the area, they were too few in number to have any real impact on the fighting. However, inside Stalingrad, men were dying randomly, without wounds or sickness. And this puzzled the Germans because the doctors believed it was too early for cases of starvation to occur. Thus, the 6th Army hadn't yet officially reported that men were dying of starvation. But they wanted to know why these men were dying. So, on the 17th, Dr. Gergesen flew into the Kessel to figure out what was going on. Gergesen started to conduct autopsies, and by the end of the month, he had concluded that half of the cases brought to him were confirmed to be death by starvation. But that meant that the other half had died for some unknown reason. It was suggested that lice had spread infections and diseases, but since a lot of the men just seemed to die randomly, that explanation didn't fit.
Gergensen became convinced that the combination of exhaustion, stress and cold gravely upset the metabolism of most soldiers. This meant that even if they received the equivalent of, say, 500 calories a day, their bodies absorbed only a fraction. Thus, they had an accelerated process of starvation.
Albert Speer reports that, as a show of support to the trapped men in the pocket, Kurt Zeitzler decided to restrict his own diet to that of the men. It's not clear how long he did this for, a few days, maybe 2 weeks, but he apparently lost 11 kilograms of weight. In The Taste of War, Collingham reports that Hitler became irritated by Zeitzler's action, and not wanting to be reminded of the reality, he ordered him to eat properly again. In other words, it's Madman Hitler time. Perhaps, though, Hitler simply didn't want his chief of staff to collapse and die of hunger or have a lack of energy at what is, perhaps, one of the most critical times of the war. And he did ban champagne and cognac at his headquarters after this point as a token gesture, so clearly he was sympathetic to the plight of the men, which is what Albert Speer had to admit himself.
After a few days of this, Hitler informed him that he considered it improper for a chief of staff to wear out his nerves with such demonstrations of solidarity with the troops.
With Manstein's relief forces bogged down at the Aksai, on the 16th, he insisted that Paulus begin the preparations for the breakout. Glantz says that this wasn't a coincidence. Manstein was struggling. He couldn't get to the 6th Army, and that fact was now obvious. So the 6th Army would have to launch its own breakout to link up with Manstein's forces.
This is an admission that the relief operation had failed, and it had failed by the 16th or 17th of December. 17th Panzer Division would help them go a bit further, but Manstein knew he couldn't reach Paulus, and Paulus's half-starved troops would have to launch their own breakout. To me, this is a sign of desperation, and it's clear that Manstein had one last roll of the die, and he had to get a 6. But maybe Paulus could add a modifier to the roll. After all, he had selected Huber to plan the breakout operation, and Huber was a decent and experienced general. If anyone was up to the task, it would be him.
And on the 17th, Huber submitted his plans. Lattmann's 14th Panzer Division would strike south, with the 3rd and 29th Motorized Divisions on the flanks, and hopefully advance the 10 kilometers to the Donskaya Zaritsa River. After this, 14th Panzer Division would move to the Buzinovka region and link up with Manstein's relief forces. Hopefully. Although no existing documents show that Paulus formally approved Huber's plan, ensuing German troop movements in the western half of the Stalingrad pocket indicate that he did.
Even if by some miracle they actually managed to do this, this still means that Manstein had to reach the Buzinovka area. Well, he was nowhere near that area right now. And while he had just received the 17th Panzer Division with its 30 panzers, was this really going to be enough to get them to the Buzinovka area? It seemed highly unlikely.
Compounding the situation for the Axis, at dawn on the 18th of December, 5th Mechanized Corps struck south with almost 100 tanks, alongside 321st Rifle Division, which was in support to the west. Kampfgruppe Weicker couldn't hold on against this overwhelming force and fell back. Nobelsdorf was concerned that the entire Axis defence in the region was about to collapse, so he ordered 11th Panzer Division to move west once more to plug the gap. With these events playing out, back in the south, Kirchner resumed his offensive, thinking they'd be able to crush 4th Mechanized Corps' defences and reach the Mishkova River. The 36th Mechanized Brigade was hit by Raus and Zenger, as well as the Luftwaffe, whose bombs smashed their headquarters while they were eating lunch. Part of the brigade was saved by the commander, who had leapt into a tank and personally entered combat, so the survivors withdrew north, allowing 17th Panzer Division to move to the area east of Verkhniekumsky. They were now on the flank of Voltsky's corps, hoping to encircle them with Raus's forces moving north. But 6th Panzer Division ran straight into the 1378th Rifle Regiment, whose commander stood his ground even when his positions were overrun. Behind them were the 17 tanks of 55th Tank Regiment, all of which were destroyed in the course of the day. The 85th Tank Brigade, having only just reinforced Voltsky's forces, also lost 14 of its 17 tanks, plus all of its equipment, and the 59th Mechanized Brigade was battered and fell back too. But these actions prevented Raus from advancing into Verkhniekumsky. Because of their performance so far, Voltsky received a telegram from Stalin informing him that his corps was being awarded the title 3rd Guards Mechanized Corps, along with more rewards for him and his troops. At least what remained of them, which wasn't much. The entire front had lost 12,718 men between the 11th and the 20th of December, with Voltsky's corps alone losing 5,566 of them. To the east, Romanian cavalry forces and Panvitz's small task force captured Zhutov by nightfall after several hours of fighting, and it's clear that the Axis had finally gotten back on the move. Were Manstein's previous doubts for nothing? Could this be the moment of truth? Well, if it was, it still required Paulus to break out. When 6th Army was first surrounded on the 21st of November, it had 40,000 combat troops. On the 6th of December, this shrank to 34,000, and now the 6th Army had 28,200 men, which was 25,000 infantry and 3,200 pioneers. Of course, this figure didn't include regiment and battalion staffs, or heavy weapons crews, or anti-aircraft gun crews, or tank and Stug crews, or various support and construction units, or even Romanian and Hiwis.
So this was just pure German infantry, and we can probably add several extra thousand troops onto it to get a more accurate figure. Nonetheless, only something like 1 in 7.5 men trapped in the pocket were combat infantry troops, which is why Army Group Don pressured Paulus to convert the other 180,000 men into combat infantry, at a time when they weren't supplying enough ammunition for the troops they had. And things were even worse than this number indicated. 77 of the army's battalions reported that they could not move at all due to a lack of horses, many of which had been moved to the rear before the encirclement, with the rest currently being eaten down by the men. So the army was basically immobile. They did have 150 tanks, but only about 50 or maybe 70 of them could be spared for the breakout, since they were under attack from all sides. The Luftwaffe also hadn't delivered the necessary fuel supplies, so even these tanks couldn't go the distance. Therefore, any breakout attempt, be it with a portion of the force or a full dash to the south, would not only have to get through the 57th Army's lines, a tall order as it was, reach the Buzinovka area, and then, after that, go two or three times further than they originally planned, which was way beyond their fuel limits or their capabilities, and all this would have to be done not only without Hitler's consent, but without Manstein's own breakout orders as well, and Paulus was having his own doubts. So even at this moment, a breakout is basically impossible, and it gets even worse. What I haven't told you yet is that the 2nd Guards Army had arrived, and was now moving into the area. They had started to cross the Don on the 17th, and by the 18th, the first elements arrived at the Mishkova River. With 122,000 men, 2,325 guns and mortars, and 469 tanks, an entire new army, larger than most Soviet armies at the time, was positioning itself directly between Manstein and Paulus. And while not all of it had arrived yet, the 1st and 13th Guards Rifle Corps had moved into position at the Mishkova, and the 2nd Guards Mechanized Corps sat behind them with more than 200 tanks. The way was now blocked for Manstein and Paulus. 51st Army had successfully held on long enough to allow the Soviets to move these forces into the area. The 6th Army, at least, knew that the 2nd Guards Army was in the area from the 17th onwards. And this is a critical element that's often forgotten about. Even before any talk of a breakout order from Manstein, Paulus knew that the 2nd Guards Army was arriving in the area that he was meant to have been rescued from. Manstein was already struggling, so any hope of Manstein getting to Stalingrad, or of Paulus breaking out of the pocket, was now gone. The relief or breakout plans died on the 17th of December, if not before. And as we'll see, Manstein knew this at the time. So, for Manstein to insist that Paulus launch a breakout, and then blame him for not doing it, is ridiculous. If Manstein couldn't break in, then Paulus definitely couldn't break out. So the arrival of the Soviet 2nd Guards Army is the final nail in the coffin for the German 6th Army. The plan for Winter Storm had been laid to rest. But it's not over until Hermann Göring sings, and Manstein wasn't about to just give in. In theory, there was still a chance that he could pull a miracle. After all, he was a genius who never lost a battle, because it was always someone else's fault, and since he was capable of creating miracles, perhaps he could pull one out of the hat right now. Was he about to part the Soviet Red Sea and deliver them from evil, or would they all drown in the flood? Let's find out. On the 18th of December 1942, Manstein sent his intelligence officer, Major Eisman, into the Stalingrad pocket to communicate with Paulus. There's some controversy over this, because some say that Manstein should have gone himself despite the danger. But he refused to do so, saying that he was too busy to leave his headquarters, which is also disputed. On this issue, Paulus supposedly said to Colonel Adam,
"Apparently the Commander-in-Chief of Army Group Don is not ready to go against Hitler of his own accord. Schmidt, too, cannot understand Manstein handling the 6th Army on the brink this way, sending us his youngest staff officer."
Perhaps it was because Manstein knew he was leaving them all to their fate and couldn't face them face to face. This might be a clue that he had already given up hope, and if so, this lends more evidence to the idea that a breakout order wasn't given. Nonetheless, Eisman told Paulus that Manstein's relief forces wouldn't be able to continue the advance for much longer, and that his forces may have to be shifted to plug the new gap in the Italian sector. It was unlikely that they would reach Buzinovka, and so Eisman asked Paulus to extend his planned breakout objective by another 25 kilometers further south. Paulus' Chief of Staff, Major General Arthur Schmidt, told Eisman that it wasn't possible for the 6th Army to do that. They didn't have enough fuel or supplies to link up with Manstein's relieving forces. He said that any breakout attempt at this time would just result in disaster, since they only had 8 or maybe 10 battalions and 50 or so tanks with which to launch the breakout. And that was assuming that they got more fuel and supplies, which seemed unlikely, so there was no chance. This is also why there wasn't a breakout order given at the time.
No, under the present circumstances, giving the order to break out would be irresponsible. I must be certain that the outside encirclement will be broken, or that Hoth is so close that we can meet up in one day. Eisman pressed them without accepting the risks of making the link-up, even on unfavourable terms. But Paulus and Schmidt steadfastly refused to begin the breakout without more supplies. Schmidt was particularly stubborn on this point. He called the airlift the chief stumbling block to success.
Well, not long after their talk with Eisman, Manstein asked Paulus for his assessment of the situation. And at 17:30 hours on the 18th of December, Paulus told Manstein that there were three options for a breakout.
Case 1, to break out through to Buzinovka to meet with Hoth is possible only with tanks, since the infantry force is lacking and therefore holding Stalingrad and the long new flanks risky. With this solution, the fortress loses all reserves with which to clean up further break-ins. Case 2, breakout without connecting with Hoth, only in the most extreme emergency. The loss of much equipment must be taken into consideration. This assumes the prior flying in of sufficient food and fuel. The combat capability of the men must be improved first. If Hoth only temporarily makes contact and brings in vehicles, this solution will be easier. The infantry divisions are currently almost immovable, and it will get worse every day, as horses need to be constantly slaughtered. Case 3, continue holding current position, depends on supply and flying in sufficient manpower. Up to now, supply has been completely inadequate. Based on the current situation, further holding is no longer possible.
So basically all three options were bad and couldn't really be done. Manstein and Paulus then exchanged some questions and answers.
When is the earliest Case 2 can begin? Preparation time, 3 to 4 days. It was the evening of the 18th, so 3 or 4 days would bring us to the 21st or 22nd of December. And I want to emphasize that this is for the preparations before they could actually begin the breakout. Why is this important? Because if Manstein wants Paulus to start the breakout on the 21st or 22nd, he needs to give the order now. If he wants Paulus to start his breakout on the 23rd, he's going to have to give him the order on the 19th, the next day, or at a push, the day after, which is the 20th. That fact will become important to this discussion in the future. How much fuel and how much food is necessary? 1.5 fuel loads, according to Senior Quartermaster Don, short rations for approximately 10 days for 270,000 men.
Bearing in mind that when Fiebig found out that he had to deliver 4,000 tons of fuel and 1,800 tons of rations into the pocket at a time when they were only delivering about 145 tons per day, he wrote in his diary that this was simply impossible to accomplish.
Hayward notes that it would have taken them a biblical 40 days and 40 nights to deliver this amount, assuming the 6th Army didn't consume any of it. So yeah, Paulus wasn't receiving the necessary fuel or food supplies, and he couldn't divide his 5 loaves and 2 fish between 249,000.
Provisionally, the previous orders stand. At 2300 hours, call again. Regards. Are there any more questions? May the Corps consider preparations for Case 2. What is the situation with Group Hot? Here is Paulus asking Manstein directly if he can initiate a full breakout. Despite all the problems, Paulus was willing to go ahead with it. Now, he's asking Manstein for permission, not because he can't make his own decisions, but because he doesn't have all the information. He's only somewhat aware of the situation outside the pocket, which is why he's asking what's going on with Hot's 4th Panzer Army. So Paulus doesn't have a complete picture of the situation and needs Manstein to inform him of what's going on and give him the green light to start his breakout. Therefore, it's down to Manstein, not Paulus, to initiate the breakout. To question 1, wait for today's evening communication. There you go, Manstein is saying don't break out, don't even prepare to break out. And this is Paulus' superior ordering him to wait. To question 2, Group Hot is continuing the attack on both sides of Verkhny-Kumsky against strong enemy forces. So Manstein has confirmed to Paulus that he's not even got his forces to the Mishkova River yet. In other words, he's miles away from where he needs to be, and he's facing strong enemy forces. So Manstein is telling Paulus that it's unlikely that he's going to get to him anytime soon, placing doubts in Paulus' mind. After a bit more back and forth, Paulus asks, "Do I get the order now?" Again, Paulus is asking for the breakout order. He wants to break out, he's not a coward, he just needs the green light, and Manstein doesn't give him the order because he needs time to get closer to Paulus. Manstein is too far away. If they attempt the breakout now, they would have to march on foot through snow in terrible conditions, half-starved, without enough supplies, something like 60 kilometers, 37 miles, if they were marching from the breakout point. Bearing in mind that, according to Colonel Adam, the 6th Army only had enough fuel for a 30 kilometer drive. But if they were coming from the Renok area, for example, they would have to march 112 kilometers, 70 miles, just to reach the area where Manstein was going to be in a few days' time. He hadn't actually reached the Mishkova River yet. If they had to go all the way to where Manstein was now, that's 135 kilometers or 84 miles. To put this into context, Google Maps says that Liverpool to Sheffield in a straight line is 100 kilometers, and this is halfway across the width of England. Over the distance from Renok to Manstein, you could walk across Italy from the Mediterranean to the Adriatic in the area southeast of Rome. And for my American viewers, you could almost cross the whole of Florida at its shortest point if you went 135 kilometers in a straight line. So this isn't exactly a walk in the park.
It's a bad enough journey in good weather when you're well fed and aren't getting shot at. But for Paulus' half-starved troops, no chance. This was going to be a struggle, and we can certainly understand why Paulus doesn't take the initiative and order his own breakout at this point. Realistically, Manstein needs to be closer than he is, which is also why Manstein doesn't order the breakout on the 18th. He tells Paulus to wait, and so Paulus does. And this is proof that Manstein was not only too far away, but he wasn't prepared to order a breakout at this time for practical reasons. It had nothing to do with Madman Hitler. Manstein needs to get closer. During the evening conversation, Paulus is also told that there were strong enemy forces to the south, and that a western breakout would be easier. This in itself is ridiculous, because the Schur area was much closer than where Manstein was and where he had started, and if he had launched his attack in the Schur area, then he may have actually been much closer to Paulus than he would ever get in the south. But of course, it was impractical for him to do that. Regardless, Glantz says that all this indecision and questionable reasoning reinforces Paulus's doubts about the breakout. So Paulus is now reluctant to take the initiative because of Manstein's information, indecision, failure to get close enough to him, and his unwillingness to personally come to see Paulus in the pocket. And this is on top of the other reasons, like the fact that the Luftwaffe hasn't delivered him enough supplies. So is it any wonder that he didn't launch a breakout at this point?
But Manstein was trying to get closer, and the fighting wasn't over yet. On the morning of the 19th, Balck's panzers and panzergrenadiers struck 5th Mechanized Corps' columns as they advanced south. According to Melithin, 15th Panzer Regiment's 25 panzers destroyed 65 Soviet tanks without a single loss in return. But Soviet sources contradict his account, stating that 11th Panzer Division did actually suffer heavy losses and was forced to go onto the defensive. It's also worth noting that the inexperienced 5th Mechanized Corps was stocked with British Lend-Lease Matilda and Valentine tanks, which might explain why they suffered heavy losses, since they were only armed with 40mm 2-pounder guns. The main action, though, was to the south. Here, Kirchner's 57th Panzer Corps tried once more to advance, this time making a bit of progress. Stukas and artillery pounded Voltsky's forces, destroying most of his remaining tanks, artillery, and radios. The loss of the radios was particularly painful because it limited Voltsky's ability to communicate with his subordinate units. 17th Panzer Division sliced through Voltsky's western flank, as 6th Panzer Division also pushed north, both aiming for Verkhny-Kumsky. 1,378th Rifle Regiment fought on as the Germans encircled them and then annihilated them by the end of the day. Soviet rocket fire and anti-tank guns smashed into the German panzers, and the Soviets sent in the last of their own tanks into the fray, to be almost wiped out before Voltsky ordered them to fall back in fear that they might be encircled. His command post was hit by artillery fire and then attacked by panzers, and the lack of working radios forced him to dispatch one of his chiefs of staff to make contact on foot, which he was only partially able to do. But even without direct orders, Voltsky's surviving remnants were compelled to fall back to the northwest, as did a small group of Aslanov's 55th Tank Regiment, which had also been surrounded but managed to get out overnight. Kirchner's forces had finally passed Verkhny-Kumsky and had raced on, reaching the Mshkova River that evening. They were victorious, but the battle had cost them dearly. 6th Panzer Division had lost 25 panzers, and the total losses for all three divisions were 33 for this day alone. 83 panzers were sat in the repair shops, and there were just 92 operational panzers left against the remaining 40 Soviet tanks. That's if you don't count the 2nd Guards Army, whose units were now at or near the Mshkova River. What also needs to be considered is that the Germans had taken 6 days to reach this point, about 68 kilometers or 42 miles, and still had another 40 kilometers, 25 miles to go to get to Buzynovka in the face of an entire new army.
Let's not forget that the Italian sector on the Don flank collapsed on this day, with the German and Romanian lines also falling back. So Manstein now had that to consider as well, and the fact that the situation around Stalingrad had taken a turn for the worse.
The Luftwaffe fighters were completely overwhelmed by the masses of Soviet aircraft over Stalingrad on this day, and in consequence, the airlift operation to Stalingrad again came to an almost complete standstill.
It's in this context that we finally get to probably the most controversial part of the entire Stalingrad story, the moment many of you have been waiting for, whether Manstein did or didn't issue the breakout order. Let's take a look.
If it wasn't clear before, by the 19th of December, Manstein, Hott and Kirchner understood what they were up against. Manstein sent a report to Hitler and the OKH at 14:35 hours, admitting that 57th Panzer Corps was too weak to break through to the 6th Army.
He stated that the 6th Army had to attempt a breakout of the pocket, which was now their only hope. He said if the 6th Army could march to the Mishkovsky-Yerik River, which is the small one between the Mishkova and Donetskaya Tsaritsa, then there might still be a chance. Only a chance though. And this is further than Paulus was hoping to go anyway. It's more than 40 kilometers to this river, and it would still be another 20 kilometers away from the 57th Panzer Corps. Bearing in mind that Manstein's forces had only gone roughly 72 kilometers over the previous 6 days in the face of one weak Soviet army, Paulus's half-starved troops were now expected to go almost the same distance against one admittedly weak Soviet army, and then a second fresh and much larger army. In other words, it's not going to happen. But here's the deal. He also tells Hitler a couple of important things. First, 6th Army's already terrible rations will only last until the 22nd of December. So, at best, they've got 2 to 3 days left to pull out a miracle. And perhaps the most important thing, considering what we're going to discuss shortly, Manstein also says this. At the same time, 6th Army needs a few days to regroup and stock up with fuel before moving off. I cannot emphasize how important this line actually is. Having watched this series, it should now be obvious that this was the case anyway. I've basically been saying this throughout this entire episode, that 6th Army wasn't ready for the breakout and needed more fuel, etc. But if you want a primary source saying it, here is Manstein himself spelling this out to Hitler. But why is this line so important? Because, supposedly, according to a lot of the historians, Manstein himself, and Wikipedia, just a couple of hours after telling Hitler this, Manstein sent a message to Paulus at 1800 hours ordering him to initiate a breakout attempt. Really? Let's say it all together now, class. But is this really the case? No, that's not what Manstein did. So, let's pull back the curtain and reveal what he actually said. Starting with his narrative. In his memoirs, Manstein says, "At noon on 19th December, therefore, the army group sent the Supreme Commander, Hitler, an urgent appeal by teleprinter to let 6th Army finally disengage from Stalingrad and drive southwest to join 4th Panzer Army." And yes, he does recommend to Hitler that they abandon Stalingrad. But there's several problems with his narrative. For starters, his message doesn't come across as an urgent appeal. It's more of a subordinate informing his boss of what's going on and giving recommendations. But by stating that it's an urgent appeal, Manstein paints it as if he's been begging Hitler for the breakout and needs him to give him permission for it right now. However, what he also says is that his forces can only be expected to reach the Yerik-Mishkova River, which is further from Stalingrad than Paulus can actually go, and worse. Manstein states that he can only reach this river if Hitler provides him with additional forces from the Caucasus. It is also vital that forces be quickly brought up from the Caucasus front to safeguard the execution of 57th Panzer Corps' task by protection of its deep right flank. In the event of delay, 57th Panzer Corps is likely to become stuck on or north of the Mishkova, or else tied down by attacks in its right flank. And then he states the line, "At the same time, 6th Army needs a few days to regroup and stock up with fuel before moving off." So Manstein openly admits to Hitler that with his current forces, he cannot even get to the Yerik-Mishkova River, which is further than Paulus could go anyway. And if by some miracle Paulus managed to get this far, Manstein also admits that he won't be able to get there either unless there's additional reinforcements from the Caucasus, which is not going to happen in the immediate future. So that's it. It's over. Here is Manstein stating to Hitler
that a breakout attempt will fail because neither Paulus nor himself can get to the Yerik-Mishkova River without a miracle on Paulus's part, and without fictional reinforcements from the Caucasus. So yeah, Manstein has just confirmed that no breakout or relief can occur, and he's told Hitler this as well. So why didn't Manstein or Hitler or Paulus issue a breakout order? Because, as Manstein himself stated, neither he nor Paulus can get to the Yerik-Mishkova River. So there you go. It's not Madman Hitler or Cowardly Paulus, and Manstein didn't give the breakout order even though he lied and said he did. Why? Because he knew it was impossible, and here is the proof of that. Yet, in his memoirs, Manstein lied. When this message too failed to evoke an immediate response, an order was issued to 4th Panzer and 6th Armies at 1800 hours, in which the latter was directed to commence breaking through to the southwest forthwith. The italics are his. He is stating that he gave the breakout order. Okay, but before we even get to that, his message to Hitler failed to evoke an immediate response because the message didn't call for an immediate breakout. Yes, he did recommend a breakout, but then stated that it was impossible for Manstein or Paulus to reach the Yerik-Mishkova River under the current circumstances, and thus no breakout could occur. But by saying it failed to evoke a response, Manstein distracts you from the facts and plays the Madman Hitler card. You know, the excuse being that Hitler didn't respond and give the order for a breakout, so it's his fault, even though Manstein's report confirms to Hitler that no breakout could actually occur. In addition to this, he also blames Paulus. Again, another distraction. Manstein claims he gave the breakout order to Paulus, and that Paulus failed to carry it out. Well, let's read the actual order, shall we? To 6th Army and 4th Panzer Army. 1. 4th Panzer Army, 57th Panzer Corps, has beaten enemy in area Verkhny-Kumsky and reached Mishkova at Nerzhny-Kumsky. Attack launched against strong enemy grouping, 2nd Guards Army, in area Kamenka and north of here. Hard fighting still expected. Situation on Sher front does not permit forces west of Don to advance on Kalach, Cherskaya in enemy hands. So he's basically said, we're nowhere near and relief is not coming, which is why this point says, 2. 6th Army will begin winter tempest attack earliest possible. Aim will be to link up with 57th Panzer Corps, if necessary by advancing beyond Donskaya Tsaritsa for purpose of getting convoy through. Out of context, it might sound like he's ordering Paulus to launch the breakout. But winter tempest isn't the breakout. Thunderclap is the breakout. Winter tempest is the relief attack, right? Yeah, but also no. Everybody thinks that winter tempest is the relief attack. And yeah, it was. But it's not just the relief attack. What most people have missed is that it's also the Buzinovka attack as well. Both the relief attack and the Buzinovka breakout are included in Winter Tempest, meaning they've already agreed upon this. They've already agreed that Paulus will launch a breakout to Buzinovka. 2. 6th Army will begin Winter Tempest attack earliest possible. This implies that Paulus already knows that Winter Tempest is the Buzinovka attack, and that it will be launched. This is because Paulus already has permission to do the Buzinovka attack. But Thunderclap is something different. That's why Manstein qualifies this by saying, if necessary, because we may not get to you, you will have to advance beyond the Donskaya Tsaritsa. And then, in the next point, which we will read in a minute, he then says that this will be called Operation Thunderclap. What we have is a small link-up operation, which is the Winter Tempest sally to the Buzinovka area, with the intention of 6th Army staying in Stalingrad. And then there's the large breakout Thunderclap operation, which is where the 6th Army basically flees from Stalingrad. If you don't realize that there's a distinction,
then what Manstein says in this order doesn't actually make sense, as you'll see shortly. But my point here is that the historians have mixed the two together into one, even though there's two types of breakout attempt, the small breakout or link up, and the large breakout where they flee. The reason why the historians have missed it is because, in the bulk of his memoirs, Manstein conflates the two together. He acts as if they are one and the same, for reasons we'll get to in a minute.
There are a couple of historians who have realised that Winterstorm and Thunderclap are two different things, but these historians are few and far between. Craig mentions it briefly in this one sentence. Having hoped to receive permission to combine Winterstorm and Thunderclap into one mighty operation, Paulus and Schmidt had been told that all they could do was attempt a link-up with the rescue force. But obviously this one sentence doesn't convey to the reader the importance of the distinction, possibly because Craig himself didn't realise the significance. And it certainly doesn't do anything compared to the sheer volume of other sources that don't make the distinction. There are a few websites that do state the difference. This one by Warfare History Network, for example, correctly points out that 6th Army would break out in two phases, and then explains Winterstorm being the first attack, with Thunderclap being the full withdrawal. However, the far more popular Wikipedia states the opposite. Manstein hoped that the 6th Army would launch an offensive of its own, from the opposite side, upon the receipt of the code signal Thunderclap. There is no mention at all of the Buzinovka Winterstorm attack, and it is directly implied in this, and most other sources as well, that the only breakout attack was Thunderclap, and that the 6th Army would launch this on its own, and this is due to Manstein's lie. The way Anthony Beaver explains it, in what is perhaps the most popular book on Stalingrad, also suggests that there weren't two breakout operations. Manstein's plan to rescue the 6th Army, Operation Winterstorm, aimed to break through to the 6th Army and establish a corridor to keep it supplied and reinforced. So Manstein's relief attack would do all the work in establishing that corridor. You know, according to this description, 6th Army has no part to play in Winterstorm. Manstein, however, instructed his headquarters to draw up a further plan in the event of Hitler seeing sense. This would include the subsequent breakout of 6th Army in the event of a successful first phase, and its physical reincorporation in Army Group Don. This second plan was given the name Operation Thunderclap. Therefore, according to this description, only Thunderclap was the breakout, and that relied on Hitler seeing sense, which is the narrative that Manstein was giving in his memoirs. Let's read point 3 of Manstein's order. 3. Development of situation may make it necessary to extend task in paragraph 2 up to Mishkova. Code word Thunderclap. In this case, the aim must likewise be to establish contact with 57th Panzer Corps in order to get convoy through, and then, by covering the flanks on the lower Karpovka, to bring army forward towards the Mishkova simultaneously with sector-by-sector evacuation of fortress area. Let's just pause a second. What he said here is this. If the situation gets out of hand, if the relief forces cannot get to Buzinovka, it may be necessary for you, Paulus, to extend the small breakout or link-up operation Winter Tempest by attacking to the Mishkova. The code word for this extension, or full breakout, is Thunderclap. In this case, the aim is to link up with the 57th Panzer Corps and then guard the flanks as you evacuate Stalingrad. This is why he then says, it is essential that Operation Thunderclap should immediately follow Winter Tempest attack, because these are two distinct breakout scenarios. You will do the small attack to Buzinovka first, Winter Tempest, and if necessary, you will immediately follow up by launching the large breakout to the Mishkova, Thunderclap. How most historians, almost all of them, have missed this is a testament to how well this was all covered up. Manstein conflated the two together in his memoirs and directly stated that Winter Storm was the relief attack. But the reality was that the attack to Buzinovka, the small breakout or link-up, was already part of the Winter Storm plan. It was already confirmed, it was already approved. And Thunderclap was an extra attack, a full breakout, that should only be implemented after Paulus got to Buzinovka. And by not distinguishing the two operations, Manstein successfully hid what was going on. And so many people, including most historians, have misread the entire situation. But by now understanding this, it makes it clear that Manstein's message on the 19th is not the breakout order, because Paulus already had permission to go to Buzinovka. Earlier on, I explained that Paulus gave three scenarios to Manstein. Case 1, to break out through to Buzinovka to meet with Hott. Case 2, break out without connecting with Hott, only in the most extreme emergency. Case 3 is him staying in Stalingrad. But case 1 is Winter Tempest, to break through to Buzinovka and meet with Hott whilst staying in Stalingrad. Case 2 is Thunderclap, breaking out without a connection with Hott, a big risk, which is why it should only be done in the most extreme emergency, because we're all going to abandon our positions and be fleeing across open territory. And then Manstein follows up with this. 2. 6th Army will begin Winter Tempest attack earliest possible. Aim will be to link up with 57th Panzer Corps, if necessary, by advancing beyond Donskaya Zaritsa for purpose of getting convoy through. And then, 3, development of situation may make it necessary to extend task in paragraph 2 up to Mishkova. Code word Thunderclap. In this case, the aim must likewise be to establish contact with 57th Panzer Corps in order to get convoy through, and then, by covering the flanks on the lower Kapovka, to bring army forward towards the Mishkova, simultaneously with sector-by-sector evacuation of fortress area. This is why it is essential that Operation Thunderclap should immediately follow Winter Tempest attack. Supply by air must be carried out in the main without advanced stockpiling. Important to hold Potomac airstrip as long as possible. All weapons and artillery which can be moved, primarily guns needed for the fighting and also any weapons and equipment which are difficult to replace, will be taken along. To this end, they will be moved in good time to the southwest of the pocket. 4. All necessary preparations to be made for action laid down in paragraph 3, only to be implemented on express issue of Thunderclap. Let's reword this. You are allowed to prepare for Thunderclap, which is paragraph 3, but you are not to launch it until I expressly give you the order. That is Manstein laying down the law. You will not do this until I say so. 5. Report day and time on which you can attack in accordance with paragraph 2, which is Winter Tempest, not Thunderclap. So, for now, we're sticking to Winter Tempest, the small breakout or link-up to Buzinovka. We're not doing Thunderclap, the full breakout. So, for now, let's stick to the small attack, which is a go, that's already locked and loaded. You have permission to do the small breakout. Now you just need to tell me when you're ready for that small breakout attack towards Buzinovka.
So this should all make sense now. Manstein is saying the link-up attack to Buzinovka is fine. We're happy with that. Just tell us a date and time when you're ready to go. But the full-on breakout where you just run away, we're not doing that just yet. That'll only happen when you've gotten to Buzinovka. But you can start preparing for it, just don't do it until I give you the code word Thunderclap. That's what Manstein is saying. So this is not the full-on breakout order. These are only the advanced instructions for it. So this distinction between the small breakout Winter Tempest and the full breakout Thunderclap has been completely missed by most, if not all, people reading about this battle. And the reason why is because Manstein deliberately didn't give the full explanation in his memoirs so as to distort history and manipulate you into blaming Hitler and Paulus. Manstein lied. He restricted what he told us in order to take the blame off himself, and it worked beautifully. But let's just go back a second. In the previous part, we heard Manstein and Paulus talking to each other, and Paulus gives the three options. Case 2 is the full-on breakout, and Manstein asks, when is the earliest Case 2 can begin? He's not even talking about Case 1, the Buzinovgru attack, because that one is already a given. That one's going to happen if Manstein gets close enough, and as I mentioned earlier in the episode, we have evidence that Paulus had started to move forces in the pocket in preparation for the small breakout or link-up. But by asking, hey, when are you ready for Case 2? Manstein is actually communicating to Paulus that Case 1 is probably not going to happen. In other words, the relief attack has failed, so Paulus says it's going to take us 3 to 4 days in order to prepare, right? And Manstein asks, how much food and fuel do you need, Paulus? And Paulus says, a ridiculous amount, because it's not just a few thousand men doing a small breakout to Buzinovka, it's everybody in the pocket. So he says he needs rations for 270,000 men. Obviously there's no way they can supply this, so Manstein then says,
provisionally, the previous orders stand. At 2300 hours, call again. Regards. Are there any more questions? And by this, he means that you're to hold on to Stalingrad, but also launch the small breakout to Buzinovka. So again, don't prepare for the full breakout just yet. And we know that the small breakout to Buzinovka is on the cards because of what Paulus says next. May the Corps consider preparations for Case 2. What is the situation with Group Hot? So he's not asking about Case 1, the small breakout to Buzinovka. He's only asking for the full breakout, because Case 1, the small breakout, is part of the previous orders that Manstein has said still stand. So this proves that Paulus had been given the green light to break out to Buzinovka, knowing that Case 1, the Buzinovka attack, is already prepared. Paulus then says, hey, can I start preparing for the full breakout, Case 2? That's why he needs to know what's going on with 4th Panzer Army, because he needs to know how far he's got to go. And Manstein responds to question 1, wait for today's evening communication. So Manstein is saying, no, don't do it yet. Don't even start preparing yet. Just wait. And then he says, to question 2, Group Hot is continuing the attack on both sides of Verkhnekumsky against strong enemy forces. In other words, strong enemy forces are in our way, but they're also in your way as well. So the subtext is, if you try and break out right now, you're going to be facing these strong forces, and that's probably not a good idea. But even after this, even after being told not to do it, Paulus again asks, do I get the order now?
Paulus is eager to go with the full breakout. He's not content to just sit there and do a Buzinovka link-up. He wants to go for the full breakout. However, he doesn't know the full situation. He's relying on Manstein to tell him what's going on, and Manstein keeps him more or less in the dark and doesn't give him the order to break out. And later on, when Manstein has realised that it's not going to happen, he writes to Hitler and says, the only option is a breakout, but neither I nor Paulus can get to the Mishkova-Yerik River. Therefore, he says to Hitler, at the moment there's no point issuing the order, we need more time to prepare. He then sent his advanced orders to Paulus saying, the small Buzinovka breakout winter storm is fine, just give me a time and a date. But the full breakout, thunderclap, shouldn't be done until I give the order to do so. But you can start preparing for it. So, Manstein didn't give the breakout order. Instead, he lied and said he had. And the reason he lied was because his lie takes the blame off of his failure to get to Paulus. And what it does is pin the blame on Paulus and Hitler. Manstein's propaganda effort was successful, which is why we're having this discussion 80 plus years later. And just in case there's still any doubt over whether Manstein did give the order or not, Colonel Adam, who was with Paulus at Stalingrad, records Paulus stating that Manstein said,
wait, implement Operation Thunderclap only on explicit orders.
Yes, it is a memoir, and Adam's source is problematic, but he was there with Paulus at Stalingrad, and he and Paulus interpreted Manstein's message as wait for explicit orders. Now, there's plenty more I could say about this, but this video is already very long, so we'll see Paulus's reaction to all this in the next episode. If I have to do more on all this, I will do. We can talk about whether he should have just attempted a full breakout or not, and I'll give quotes from historians saying how Manstein didn't actually give the breakout order, because Hayward, Glantz, Beaver, and several other more modern historians all now say that Manstein didn't actually give the order. So regardless of the two breakout operation issue, it's not just me saying that no order was given, it's now become mainstream. But we'll leave that discussion until then. In the meantime, subscribe if you haven't done so already, let me know what you guys think in the comments, and thanks for watching, bye for now.